opportunities that may be open to us. Our budget amendment will deliver a budget for all our residents, those people who need the council to support them and not ignore them. How can it be right, Mr. Mayor, to have a council where staff numbers, buildings and assets have dramatically shrunk, and yet a number of senior officers are able to obtain salaries above that of the Prime Minister? How can it be right, Mr. Mayor, to have a council where we have salaried officers appointed by this Cabinet without any reference to the Employment and Appointment Committee? And how can it be right, Mr. Mayor, to have overstaffed departments to deliver spin and where transformation of this council hasn't even achieved any savings, Mr. Mayor? So Labour, once again, failing for the people of Wirral in the delivery of their budget. Labour clearly believe that because they don't have local elections this year, they can run roughshod over local people, and they think that residents will forget. But residents will not forgive, and they will not forget, because year on year you have taken cash out of their wallets and failed to spend it wisely. They will vote next year not only with their wallets but with their feet.
Say it.
So Mr. Mayor, continue in this arrogant manner, telling people you know best, and you will turn their backs, they will turn their backs on you. People don't trust this administration any longer. They don't trust Labour locally and they don't trust Labour nationally. And as I think my colleague over here said, you had a good awakening clearly in Salford when the Conservatives took a Labour vote, and you had an even ruder awakening in Copeland nationally, where again the Tories took a strong Labour held ward. Mr. Mayor, neither this budget that the Labour Group have put forward or any amount of spin will save them from the electorate. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Themselves going to the war, and ourselves as net losers.
I do wish that I did have a sort of time machine to wind aspects of the clock back and avoid the banking crisis. Not long ago, Sonic was a crystal ball. Then George Davis did talk about the Chancellor's Exchequer being held bent on a surplus. My understanding is that there's a substantial amount required to pay off the growing past debts, and that we'd be lucky to see much of it for real services. Perhaps I should thank Councillor Hale for his wit, because when we've been here for as long as Councillor Hale has, we've seen every possible combination of budget problem. But of course, he remains cheerful and we're all pleased to see his Britain's greater strength and is restored to better health to remind us of past difficulties. Deal with some of the points that were raised. Councillor Ellis is always very cheerful and amusing, but behind that, and behind the issues raised about agricultural and planning by other councillors, is a need to make sure that good agricultural land is not built on, and that the housing we have is for the needs of local people and not for the needs of the developers. I want to turn to some of the issues that were raised too. Councillor Williamson talked about Mrs. May and public service ethos being lacking. I think the problem is that for Mrs. May is the problem of a comfortable background. Despite having been brought up in the house of the clergy, I think the problem is that when people reach a certain level, they become very comfortable and they don't realise some of the difficulties facing ordinary people. Gunnar Johnson referred to the Surrey deal. We haven't yet seen it. We've seen emails, we've seen tweets, we've seen various things. And like Councillor Redding, I'm waiting to see if there is something special for Surrey. Because if there is, then I think Councillor Green and Councillor Davis and myself ought to save up the train fare and go down and complain bitterly on behalf of that. I want to touch finally on some points made by Councillor Clements about volunteers in country parks, because there is an issue, I think, that we're expecting people to help their community, to give time to their neighbourhood and to go along, and then we're facing car parking charges. So if there is a way around that, I'd be grateful if it being found. Now, the real problem we have is if we don't get more houses in the right place, and if we don't get the business rates in from new development, then we have that gap to be filled. And therefore, if it requires confidence in the systems that are being set up to tackle that, then I'm glad to take part in that. The problem is that confidence is undermined when we fear that, say, a certain person is appointed to a job. It undermines confidence in the system we need to get things right. Finally, I'm going to go back to the Lib Dem budget amendment. We've all heard about World View, but it's been blamed by Inc. Big Distribution. We've all heard about agency costs. Well, we want those managed. We've heard about the car parking, and we've had a long debate about that, but I still don't believe the retail sector is strong enough to increase with higher charges. In the budget amendment, I talk about the integrated transport budget. It took until June for the constituency committees to hear what they were getting, and some have now only just managed to plan the work, because they've reached agreement about how to spend it. So if Councillor Whittingham has any influence on getting us the figures for the constituency committees there, that would be greatly appreciated. Finally, I'm going to talk about the roads again. I'm on a roll now. We were told some months ago about how good quality our roads were, and we should wait to see the figures. The figures were contained in the 27th February Cabinet, and so the C-class roads, no longer 5%, 6% now require attention. So I hope that that due note should be taken about that. Finally, I know members may not be particularly inspired by the Lib Dem budget, but my colleague Councillor Kelly did a great deal of work on the issue of schools. So I'm grateful for the assurances. Thank you. Grateful for the assurances about looking at apprenticeships seriously.
Councillor Green, you have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And first of all, could I join with other colleagues in congratulating Paul Stewart, Warren Wood and Tony Jones on their famous speeches, all of which Mr. Mayor, I've been a little disappointed with the Labour Party in terms of their response to their own budget, really. I suppose the least disappointing would be Brian, of course, Brian Kenny, who asked us, when will enough, when will we say enough is enough? Well, either I didn't emphasise enough, or you weren't listening, Brian, though I didn't ever relate to you when I knew your explanation was coming. £188,120 on a programme manager. A further £181,471 on a second programme manager. £139,080 on an interim head of transformation. Well, we also have a director of transformation, £600,000 to Capita, and I don't know whether you saw the TV programme. So, to be honest, when we start, when you start resolving some of this stuff, then we'll start believing that you are serious about saving money and utilising the money that you get properly. Then, of course, we were told all this great, stuff, in her opinion, that's coming down the track. Well, why don't we hear that? Well, apparently, the way it works is we somehow find this money to give to Capita. I'm not sure whether that went through any particular government's arrangements, and it was agreed that was going to happen, what the outcomes were going to be. It then goes to some sort of joint meeting between the SLT and the cabinet. And then it goes off at some point once they've decided what options they want. Then it might appear at cabinet. And then it goes off to Anne in her portfolio board with one other member, one other councillor that gets to see that, who happens to be, apparently, the chair of the Labour group. That's the sort of governance that this council is operating over, something that is so important. And no doubt that's why Anne can confidently predict all these things are going to happen, when no one, not even our staff, have got a clue what's coming down the line towards them. There are some of the issues that if the council was more open and transparent and had proper governance, we wouldn't be wasting £1.3 million on teams and on consultants and contractors. So, right, that would be a start. So maybe we'd make a start there. Then, of course, and this is one of the things that I find the most offensive about the Labour group, is how they so easily and blindly throw racism around. So anyone else is automatically racist. We did. We heard it from Councillor Jones saying, oh, this racism is being targeted, groups are being targeted. Can I remind you who it was that said the campaign slogan was British jobs for British people? Can I remind you who that was? Gordon Brown, the same bloke who wrecked the economy that we're trying to recover, and, right, and the other comment, George, the person that stuffed the banking system with gold. That's who made that phrase. So don't ever, ever come to Conservative groups to say the Conservative group that we are targeting groups and using that for political gain, because it is simply
to be a 10%, you know, cut off every budget head. That was how they made the budget balance. But can I just say, make a serious comment, really? I think I'm really appalled by one particular officer of this council. They are targeted for a very personal and a very nasty campaign. And, you know, I absolutely get the fact that, you know, for myself as leader of the council and my other colleagues, you know, we need to withstand the early political debate. But for an officer who can't answer back, I think, and whose family and children have been affected by the relentless criticism and the absolutely awful abuse on social media, I hope they would examine their consciences.
Proud of the Labour budget.